Melissa Bensouda, and I work in the financial services industry. I have done so for over 23 years. I am also a kidney patient who was diagnosed with kidney disease nearly 20 years ago. I perform home hemodialysis, and I'm currently awaiting a transplant. I'm honored to serve as an AAKP ambassador for the state of Texas. And today, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Phil Gauthier, Medical Director of Natera Organ Health, who will present on emerging innovation in kidney disease with global implications, cell-free DNA and genetic testing research.
Hello, I'm Dr. Phil Gauthier, the Medical Director of Organ Health for Natera and a transplant physician. I'd like to start by thanking the AAKP and George Washington University for inviting me to give this seminar. Today, I would like to talk to you about a really great emerging innovation in kidney disease with global implications, and that is cell-free DNA and genetic testing. So our mission is personal at Natera. Our founder, Matt Rabinowitz, had a very personal and moving story, which explains why he founded this company and why we do what we do. And you can see the story on the slide, but basically his sister had a son with Down syndrome who died tragically very soon after birth. It was a devastating experience. So he founded this company because he believed that all families should have access to early detection of genetic disease, and that's what we do. So we are a company that does cell-free DNA. And what is cell-free DNA? Well, cell-free DNA is exactly that. It's a DNA that's found in the bloodstream. It's not in any cells. It can be detected through a blood test and analyzed and can give you all kinds of information. We also do genetic testing. We've been doing cell-free DNA and genetic testing for over 10 years. We've performed well over 2 million tests and will probably exceed 3 million by the end of 2020. We combine a novel molecular method with a powerful bioinformatics model. We have three divisions, and I'll talk to you briefly about each one, but the focus of this talk is about organ transplant. So our first division is our women's health division. Our next division is oncology, and our most recent division is the organ transplant division. So we put patients first, and we're very provider friendly. We've done over 4,000 patient genetic information sessions via telephone with one of our over 50 board certified genetics counselors. We also have a new Natera Education virtual assistant that we call Neva. This is an online resource for patients to understand test results and ordering procedures. We've had over 2,000 sessions with this assistant just in the first few months. We also have a mobile blood draw program, which I'll talk to you more about later, which we've used to prevent patients from being unnecessarily exposed to the COVID virus. And we've done over 5,300 tests using this service. And then finally, we have a Natera's virtual learning program, which we use to educate providers around our tests and their best use of our tests. We've done over 1,000 of these sessions, and we make a charitable contribution for each completed program to either the March of Dimes or the American Kidney Fund. So our women's health division, we have a test called Panorama. This is a non-invasive prenatal test. It can be done as early as 9 weeks gestation. It's a simple blood test. And the way this test works is really cool. So what we do is we get the blood from the woman, and we look for the cell-free DNA from the fetus, and we can identify the cell-free DNA from the fetus because it's genetically different from the mom. And we look for something called SNPs, which stands for single nucleotide polymorphisms. And that's a big word, but it's really just referring to the letters that make up DNA that are different between different people. We don't need any genetic information from dad to be able to do this. We're just looking for cell-free DNA that's different from the mother. Once we find that cell-free DNA, we can analyze it and we can detect all kinds of genetic variants such as Down syndrome, other trisomies. We can detect sex chromosomal abnormalities and various other chromosomal issues, again, as early as 10 weeks gestation or even 9 weeks gestation. And this is all done non-invasively without any amniocentesis or CVS. We also have an oncology division, and we have a test called Signatera. And this test is not designed to diagnose cancer, but what it is designed to is tell you if the cancer is coming back. So if you have a cancer, the tumor is removed, a piece of the tumor sent to our lab. We design a custom test that's just for you, and it's based on the differences in the tumor's DNA from your own DNA, because cancers do have different DNA from the patients that are affected. We then look for circulating tumor cell-free DNA in the bloodstream with a blood test. If we find that tumor DNA, this can be a sign that the tumor is coming back. In fact, a positive Signatera test can predict that the tumor is coming back up to 9 months before it could be detected clinically or by any kind of x-rays or other radiologic procedures. Obviously, this is very useful to make sure that you can get very prompt treatment to prevent the tumor from coming back in a more clinical way. So our cell-free DNA test in transplant is called Prospera, and I'm going to spend some time talking about this because this is a very important innovation in the transplant space. So our Prospera test gives you optimized surveillance for even more confident results using precise cell-free DNA testing from the experts. It is covered by Medicare. So before we talk to you about Prospera, let's spend a minute on active rejection. So after kidney transplants, there's always a concern that you could have what's called active rejection. And this is one type of complication that you can have after your kidney transplant surgery. It can occur weeks, months, or even years after the surgery. And it's because your immune system recognizes the kidney as a foreign body and tries to attack it like it would for a virus infection or other infection. Now, there are several blood tests that can detect rejection, and I'm going to review all of those with you. What's very important to know about rejection is that in most cases, you feel completely normal. You have no idea that you have rejection unless the rejection is very, very advanced, which is rare. When you know about rejection as soon as possible, it's much more easy to treat it, and the kidney can be prevented from progressing to failure and needing another transplant or going back on dialysis. Because early detection of rejection is so important, it's very important to accurately monitor transplant patients for rejection. So there are basically four ways to monitor for rejection. The most common way is something called serum creatinine. And this is a blood test that's very commonly done. Almost every time you have blood work, even if you're not a transplant patient, you get a serum creatinine. The problem is, as I'll show you in another slide, serum creatinine is really not very accurate to detect rejection. Many patients will have rejection with no changes in their serum creatinine. Also, a change in serum creatinine can mean many things besides rejection. It's really just not the best test. Another way to look for rejection is by looking for something called donor-specific antibodies, which are antibodies you make to the kidney. This can be a sign that your immune system is recognizing the kidney. The problem with using this to monitor for rejection is it's often a very late finding. In fact, it often happens after you've already had rejection. And in some cases, it was a rejection that wasn't detected clinically. Probably the best way to detect rejection is still a biopsy. And this involves putting a needle in the kidney, taking out a small piece, and looking it under the microscope. Of course, biopsies are invasive. There are some complications. They're generally safe, but occasionally patients have bleeding, and rarely we do see patients actually lose their kidney from a complication of biopsy. They're also expensive. They require a trip to the hospital. They require no physical activity or heavy lifting for up to 3 days after the biopsy, and they can be very complicated in patients who are on blood thinners. Our test is different. The Prospera test is a non-invasive blood test. It's optimized technology that's highly accurate to assess all types of active rejection. It's much better than creatinine and donor-specific antibodies. It's probably about as good as biopsy, maybe even a little better, but obviously it's non-invasive and there's no complications. So that's why it's a better test overall. So the way this test works is we get a sample of the transplant patient's blood. And again, we look for SNP differences. So patients who have a kidney transplant may have DNA in their blood from the donor. And just as we can recognize DNA from the fetus as being different from the mom, we can also recognize DNA from the kidney transplant as being different from the recipient. Again, we look for these SNP or single nucleotide polymorphism differences. Now, when the kidney is healthy and everything's going well, we see very little donor-derived cell-free DNA. Sometimes we can't detect any. Sometimes we detect a small amount. It's less than 1% or 1 out of 100. On the other hand, if the kidney is experiencing rejection, there'll be an elevated amount of donor-derived cell-free DNA 1% or higher. And this can be a sign that there is actually rejection of the kidney, and it's releasing this DNA into the bloodstream because the cells are being injured by the recipient's immune system. So let's compare three different tests, sensitivity, and I'll explain what that means in a second. So first is our Prospera test. So we have 89% sensitivity. So that means if you have 100 patients with rejection, our test will detect 89 of those cases. 11 patients will not be detected and will have a false negative. So it's really quite good. Just to show you how quickly this technology has advanced, let's look at the first generation donor-derived cell-free DNA test that came out several years ago. This test has a 59% sensitivity. So out of 100 patients with rejection, it will detect 59 and it will miss 41. The worst of these is creatinine. Creatinine only has a 52% sensitivity, so it misses almost half of the patients that have rejection. And this is why I said earlier serum creatinine is not the best test. So you can see quite easily from this slide that Prospera is just much more sensitive and much more accurate to detect rejection than either serum creatinine or the older first-generation donor-derived cell-free DNA test. The report is very comprehensive that your physician or other provider will receive when she or he orders this test. If the test result is above 1% or at 1%, this will be marked as a positive test, which may mean that active rejection is occurring. There are several different types of rejection. This test does not distinguish between the different types of rejection. So if the test is positive, you may still need a biopsy to see what exactly kind of rejection that you have, but your provider will discuss this with you. If it's in the normal range, this is a very reliable indicator that the kidney is fine, that there's nothing to worry about. We do also give you a comprehensive view of all the previous results because there are many providers who feel that a change is more important than an absolute level. So even if you're below 1%, but your level did go up significantly, they may want to do additional tests such as a biopsy. So we give your providers a very nice graph, as you can see reproduced here, that shows you all your results that you've ever had with us over time. Now, I mentioned earlier our mobile phlebotomy program, so I'd like to talk to you about that a little bit more. We call it ProReach, and we have a nationwide mobile phlebotomy network. We also have a partnership with a premier national lab. And we are now able to offer the mobile phlebotomy service, which is a free service to draw not only Prospera, but also all your other routine post-transplant labs that your providers order for you on a regular basis. There's a list of the labs there, as you can see on the right. It basically includes everything that your provider would want to order on a regular basis. There may be some additional tests that you need from time to time, but when you get your normal set of transplant labs, this will be completely covered with the mobile phlebotomist. So it's very easy to schedule. We can do it online. Your provider can schedule it for you. Of course, you will schedule the actual appointment with the mobile phlebotomist because since your providers don't know when you'll be home. And this is a great way to avoid coming into the hospital, to avoid COVID exposure, or to go to an actual lab. So now let's talk about another exciting product that we just came out with. This is our renal genetics panel. It's called Renasight, and it's a genetics panel for patients with chronic kidney disease, as well as many patients with kidney stones and electrolyte disorders, so high or low potassium, things like that. And the reason this test is important is because of the statistics that I'm showing you on this slide. So chronic kidney disease, abbreviated CKD, affects over 10% of the world's population. In fact, in the United States, it affects over 34 million people. It's about one out of seven people. So it's actually a very common disease, much more so than is usually appreciated. About 25% or a quarter of patients with chronic kidney disease do have a family history, which suggests a lot of it does have a genetic basis. Most kids with chronic kidney disease, about 90%, it's actually a genetic cause. We also see a lot of patients with end-stage renal disease. Those are patients on dialysis who have unknown etiology, meaning that nobody knows exactly why their kidneys failed. It's about 10% of those patients on dialysis, or one out of 10, have an unknown etiology. And it's important to know if you have a genetic chronic kidney disease because it can be very different from other types of kidney disease in the way it's treated and how quickly it's going to get worse and what it means for your life going forward. With this in mind, we have developed the Renasight Genetic Testing Panel. It's a panel of 382 genes, which is basically all the genes that are associated with a whole bunch of different types of kidney disease. You can see them on the slide. It includes cystic, tubular, glomerular, complement-related, congenital, and structural chronic kidney disease, as well as nephrolithiasis, which is kidney stones, and electrolyte disorders. We're at 382 genes now, but as we do more research and hear from our providers and patients, we will, of course, improve and expand that as we need to. The panel is expertly curated, meaning that these genes have been very carefully selected by experts to give you the genes that you need to analyze in order to determine if your kidney disease has a genetic cause. We have more than 99% detection rate for all the genes. So if you have a variant in one of these genes that you need to know about, we will find it. The best part about this test, in my opinion, is that it comes with genetics information sessions over the phone with one of our more than 50 board-certified genetics counselors, both before the test and after the test. And this is included in the price of the test. And this is important because genetics is very complicated. It's really great for patients to be able to talk to an expert about their results and also before the test to talk about to the experts about what they might expect. There are several great uses for the test, and these are outlined here. So the first is to confirm or reclassify a clinical diagnosis. We do find in several studies that a number of patients who were told that their kidney disease was due to whatever disease turns out they have something else when they get a genetics panel, and that the clinicians did not know exactly what was causing their kidney disease. Now, sometimes the clinicians suspect it might be a genetic kidney disease based on family history, and in that case, the test confirms it. And it's always good to know exactly what kidney disease you have so that we can tell you what we expect is going to happen to you in the next few years or decades. It can also target therapies or workups. So there are, although there's not normally treatment for genetic diseases, there are some important exceptions. There are several types of genetic diseases that do have treatments. We're also discovering very rapidly how to treat genetic diseases. There's something called interfering RNA that can actually block a gene from having a bad effect on your body. And we're just starting to develop those drugs. So in the future, I think we're going to see that a lot of these genetic diseases can, in fact, be treated. Of course, you have to know you have it before you can treat it. It can also provide a diagnosis for unknown etiology. As I said earlier, a number of patients with chronic kidney disease are told by their providers that, look, we just don't know what's wrong with your kidneys. We've done a bunch of tests and we don't know what's wrong. And that can be very scary for patients. So by doing genetics testing, you can actually get a diagnosis and be given a name for what's wrong with you, whereas before you didn't know that. It can be very important for family counseling and planning. If you find that you do have a genetic kidney disease, then obviously you may want your kids to be tested or your siblings to be tested. And this could really help them because then they can take certain measures with their lifestyle, controlling blood pressure, earlier access to physicians that could prevent them from getting the same kidney disease that you have. It can also dictate the need for extra renal referrals. So what does that mean? So a number of kidney diseases can also affect the eyes and the ears. And if you don't know that you have one of those diseases, you may not be aware that you need to see an eye doctor and an ear doctor. Now, we kidney doctors can take care of a lot of things, but we can't take care of your ears or your eyes. So we need to know if you need to be referred to those providers. This is especially important for little kids because little kids may not tell you that they can't see, and they may not tell you that they can't hear. And by the, if you don't find out till they're 8 or 9, they may have already experienced severe delays in their language development. And finally, clinical trials. As I mentioned earlier, we're getting a lot closer to being able to treat a lot of diseases. So there's a lot of clinical trials that are going on. To be in one of these trials, though, you do have to have the genetic diagnosis. So if you get the panel and we find that you have something, you may be able to enroll in a clinical trial that can possibly get you some good treatment and or help future patients to be given effective treatment. So this is a paper that came out in the New England Journal of Medicine late last year that just shows you how important renal genetics testing can be. They found 167 patients that had a genetic diagnosis from their kidney disease, and they found out that in 89% of those patients, the clinical diagnosis actually was very significant. Either it changed the management of the patient, or it changed the prognosis, meaning the doctors had a better idea whether this patient was going to do well or not do well. Or, as I mentioned earlier, it indicated that they needed to see other specialists for other problems that are associated with their genetic kidney disease. So the conclusion of this study was that genetic testing was really very useful for almost 90% of these patients that received a genetic diagnosis. They also, in a number of cases, reclassified a disease. So patients had initially been given the wrong diagnosis and they got a better one, or it identified a cause for a previously undiagnosed condition, or it gave you a more refined diagnosis. So it gave a subcategory to a previous diagnosis, or it confirmed that they did, in fact, have a hereditary kidney disease. So we are committed, as I said earlier, to supporting providers and patients. And we do this with our clinical services, our easy ordering and sample collection, and our affordable testing. So we do have, as I mentioned, pre and post test information sessions with the board certified genetic counselors. And we do, of course, have interpreter services available. We have a dedicated team at Natera to provide clinical support to clinicians for ordering our genetics panel and indeed all our tests. It's very easy to get the renal genetics test. You can order and collect the samples remotely. It can actually be done with saliva. You don't even need to have a blood test. We can send you a special tube and you can fill it with saliva. Or if you prefer to have a blood test, we can use our mobile phlebotomist to go to your home and draw the blood at your home. It's very affordable. It is covered by Medicare. We welcome all other insurances as well. We have a variety of payment options, many of which are income and family size based. So you will not find this test to be prohibitively expensive. And the really nice thing about genetics tests is you only ever need them once because your DNA doesn't change, unlike your other tests that your clinicians may be ordering where you have to get them every month or every 3 months or every 6 months, whatever. You're only ever going to get this test once. So think about that when you think about the cost of this test. So I thank you very much for your attention. And I'd again like to thank the AAKP and GW for inviting me to give this session. If you have any further questions, these are a variety of ways you can contact us. You can call us, you can reach us over the web or by email. And we have separate numbers and web addresses for our Prospera transplant rejection assessment test and our Renasight kidney gene panel. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you found that session informative.
We appreciate Dr. Gauthier for taking his time to share insights on research in cell-free DNA and genetic testing, and how timely research and innovation can improve patient lives and society.